I know peaches are in season, but how about impeaches? Let's plumb this topic together, shall we? Who says humor is fruitless? I'll show myself out. It seems like we've been hearing the I word a heck of a lot during the Trump presidency. And yet, guess who's still president? Democrats are calling for the House to open an impeachment inquiry into President Donald Trump, citing what they consider to be numerous offenses, such as obstructing justice, violating the Emoluments Clause of the Constitution in order to benefit his businesses, and a little thing I call undermining the freedom of the press. Yeah, it's a big one. But it's not that easy. There's a long road to successfully impeaching a sitting U.S. president. How do I know that? A little document I like to call the U.S. Constitution. Now, the Founding Fathers, who definitely had a lot of other things on their plates, I've seen Hamilton, decided to devote a good amount of ink to how impeachment would actually work. And this was real ink. There was no spell check. It was different times. They didn't even have air conditioning. Article 1, Section 2 of said Constitution says this, quote, "The House of Representatives shall choose their speaker and other officers and shall have the sole power of impeachment," end quote. So impeachment has to start in the House. The full House would need to authorize one of its committees, usually the Judiciary Committee, to investigate the person in question. If the committee determines that there's some there, it can send its articles of impeachment back to the full chamber. Then the House votes with a simple majority. Now, since Democrats control the House right now, they could easily do this along partisan lines like tomorrow, but that would just be step one. Article 2, Section 3 sends the whole matter over to the Senate. Quote, "The Senate shall have the sole power to try all impeachments. When sitting for that purpose, they shall be on oath or affirmation. When the President of the United States is tried, the Chief Justice shall preside, and no person shall be convicted without the concurrence of 2/3 of the members present," end quote. Now, it is convenient that it seems like almost everyone in Congress is already a lawyer, because the Senate piece of impeachment involves a trial where members of the House are the prosecutors and senators are the jury. Bum bum. 2/3 of the senators would need to vote to convict. A little back of the envelope math will tell you that that's at least 67 senators. And with the current party breakdown, that means a whopping 20 Republican senators would need to vote to impeach Trump, assuming, that is, that every Democrat also voted that way. Now, only 19 people have even made it to this point in the process. The Senate has conducted impeachment proceedings against presidents, judges, a cabinet secretary, and even one of their own. Et tu, Brute? But to remove any of those people requires convincing a lot of people to go along with it. Of those 19 impeachment proceedings, only 8 people have been convicted. And for what can a president be impeached? I'm glad you asked. Thanks for coming. The Constitution covers that too in Article 2, Section 4. Quote, "The president, vice president, and all civil officers of the United States shall be removed from office on impeachment for and conviction of treason, bribery, or other high crimes and misdemeanors," end quote. Now, that other high crimes and misdemeanors line allows for quite a bit of wiggle room for would-be impeachers. It lowers the bar, which is part of the reason that every president since Ronald Reagan has at least been threatened with impeachment. Now, that doesn't make it any less serious, of course. Congress did lean on other high crimes and misdemeanors for both instances of presidential impeachment. First, in 1868, when it levied an eye-popping 11 articles of impeachment against Andrew Johnson. And then in 1998-1999, when Bill Clinton was accused of perjury and obstruction of justice. And yet, neither of them was convicted or removed from office, even though in Clinton's case, his Republican rivals controlled both the House and the Senate. Again, it's just a lot of people you have to get on board with an idea that could do tremendous damage to the country's politics and overall morale. So right now, Democrats only have control of the House. That divisiveness is one of the excuses House Speaker Nancy Pelosi has offered as to why she is not one of the growing numbers in her party calling for impeachment publicly. Quote, "I'm not for impeachment," Pelosi told the Washington Post back in March. Impeachment is so divisive to the country that unless there's something so compelling and overwhelming and bipartisan, I don't think we should go down that path because it divides the country. And he's just not worth it," end quote. Pelosi's got a point. As I mentioned in our episode on Pelosi impeachment way back in May, that was a good episode, fine wine. Impeaching Trump could epically backfire on Democrats heading into the 2020 election cycle. They've got plenty of races to focus on winning instead of trying to undo a race that they, sorry Democrats, already lost. It would, simply put, turn Trump into a victim, a place he loves to be. Impeaching Trump in the House without a real chance of the Senate following suit hands the president the ability to say that Democrats hate him so much that they are unfairly targeting him and ignoring their responsibilities to the country. Trump has, in fact, basically already rolled out that argument. Quote, "The Democrats are getting zero work done in Congress," he tweeted back in May. "All they are focused on is trying to prove the Mueller report wrong. The witch hunt," end quote. Impeachment proceedings. They also take a very long time, not a quick process. Instead of focusing that time and energy on an impeachment that could well blow up in their faces, Nancy Pelosi wants her party to follow the successful blueprint that she employed in the 2018 midterm elections, which focused on talking about healthcare and other kitchen table issues important to voters. But instead of presenting a united front as we hurtle toward that 2020 election year, more than 80 House Democrats have peeled off from Pelosi's "impeachment just ain't worth it" official line. Take Texas Congressman Al Green, who has been talking about impeachment since at least the firing of former FBI Director James Comey way back in May 2017. Now, Green said in July 2019 that he planned to force a vote on impeachment. It's not the first time he's done this. Green forced two procedural votes in December 2017 and January 2018 on impeaching Trump when Republicans controlled Congress, and both of those measures were easily defeated. But now, with Democrats in control, those votes could actually mean something. Green, of course, knows that all of this might not endear him to Nancy Pelosi and the rest of the leadership. Quote, "I don't know that all of the members will be governed by one person's opinion," Green has said of Pelosi, adding, "All members should vote their conscience. And my belief is Speaker Pelosi will encourage people to vote their consciences," end quote. Is that your belief? Interesting. At the end of the day, members of the House answer to their constituents, and right now they don't have the votes that would make an impeachment inquiry anything other than a symbolic decision that could amount to a waste of time. The likeliest way for Democrats to get Donald Trump out of office is through the 2020 election, not the constitutional slog that is impeachment. And that is the point. We make these episodes every Tuesday and Thursday. Check them all out.